Good evening. Thank you. Good evening. I'm Jennifer Raab and have the extraordinary privilege of being the president of this wonderful institution, Hunter College. It is a pleasure to welcome you to the opening of this Presidential Leadership Forum, Revisiting the Great Society and the Role of Government from FDR to LBJ to today. Given the close ties between Hunter College and the Roosevelts, there could be no more appropriate setting for this historic conference. Roosevelt House, Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt's New York City home, where they lived from their marriage to his inauguration, is just 3 blocks from Hunter College. A wonderful bond was created back in the 1920s between these neighbors, and it was FDR himself who suggested that Hunter buy the house after his mother, Sarah, who also lived with them there, but that is another story, died in 1941. Franklin donated the first $1,000 to Hunter towards the $50,000 purchase price. As stewards of this historic and architectural gem, we celebrate the significant events that happened in this home. During the 4 hectic months between the 1932 election and the 1933 inauguration, many of FDR's signature programs, unemployment insurance, public works, other examples, were hatched in its halls. It was in his library on the second floor of Roosevelt House that FDR asked Frances Perkins to serve as his Secretary of Labor, making her the first woman to serve in a presidential cabinet. She accepted on one condition, that he supports Social Security, the cornerstone of the New Deal. And so how wonderful that many of you will spend tomorrow at Roosevelt House discussing the Great Society in the rooms that gave birth to the New Deal. The ties run even deeper, though, because as many of you know, Franklin Roosevelt was Lyndon Johnson's mentor and his hero. FDR gave LBJ his first big federal position in 1935, making him the Texas director of a national program to help young people stay in school and get job training. Johnson did such a masterful job that the Texas Project became a model for the nation, and in 1936, FDR went down to have a firsthand look. Witnesses say Roosevelt threw his head back and roared with laughter as his motorcade passed a roadside project where Johnson had his boys saluting the president with shovels at present arms. It was after this trip that FDR made a fateful prediction to Harold Ickes. In the next generation, he said, the balance of power will shift south and west, and this boy, meaning Johnson, could well be the first Southern president since the Civil War. Roosevelt did all he could to make this prediction come true. He played a pivotal role in helping young Lyndon win his first election to Congress and served as a mentor and confidant. The depth of their bond was captured in LBJ's mournful quote to the New York Times after Roosevelt's death. Johnson said, "He was just like a daddy to me, always." FDR and LBJ's belief in the positive power of government is reflected in Hunter's commitment to promote civic engagement as a part of a liberal arts education. Ever since its founding in 1870, Hunter, as a public institution, has provided a gateway to the American dream for immigrants, minorities, and the children of working class families, most of them the first in their families to go to college. We train our students to be grateful for what society has provided for them and urge them to fulfill the Hunter motto, mihi cura futuri, the care of the future is mine. And so we are grateful to host a spectacular conference linking FDR to LBJ and thank the many people who made it possible. I want to single out 2 in particular, Jonathan Fanton and Joseph Califano. As our interim director, Jonathan has played a transformational role in creating a world-class public policy institute at Roosevelt House. He had the vision to recruit Joe Califano to serve on our advisory board, and Joe had the genius to propose this conference. Together, they secured the funds and recruited the extraordinary list of participants, including 2 of America's most beloved figures, George McGovern and Walter Mondale, here tonight. And Joe, on a personal note, thank you not just for this program, but being a lifelong inspiration. When you were the secretary, I was a graduate student intern at the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare. That was a time when a federal intern was still an innocent position. You were an outstanding example of a great public servant then, and I am still learning from you now. Now it is a great pleasure to introduce two very special stewards of the LBJ legacy. The first is LBJ's remarkable daughter, Lucy Baines Johnson. Lucy, you've done so much to perpetuate and to protect your father's great legacy. Please stand so we can recognize your contributions. Such an honor to have you. And now it is an honor to bring to the stage Mark Updegrove, director of the Johnson Presidential Library and Museum. Mark is an award-winning historian. His third book on the American presidency, Indomitable Will, LBJ and the Presidency, will be released this week. Mark, we look forward to reading this important work. As fellow stewards of presidential legacies, it has been an honor to work with you and the LBJ Library and to welcome you here tonight. Mark Updegrove.
Thank you, President Raab. It is altogether appropriate that this conference be held at Hunter College and at Roosevelt House, where we will convene tomorrow. Lyndon Johnson, as President Raab mentioned, was a protege of Franklin Roosevelt, who served as president when LBJ was first elected to Congress in 1936. LBJ, a New Dealer by background and at heart, believed in FDR and his vision for America. In many ways, the seeds of LBJ's great society were planted in the fields of FDR's New Deal. As Johnson often said to his aides during his administration, "I really intend to finish Franklin Roosevelt's revolution." But LBJ's passion for social justice came well before FDR landed in the White House. In 1965, before a joint session of Congress, LBJ talked about an experience as a young man that may have been among the most formative of his life.
My first job after college was as a teacher in Cotulla, Texas, in a small Mexican-American school. Few of them could speak English, and I couldn't speak much Spanish. My students were poor, and they often came to class without breakfast, hungry. And they knew, even in their youth, the pain of prejudice. They never seemed to know why people disliked them, but they knew it was so, because I saw it in their eyes. I often walked home late in the afternoon after the classes were finished, wishing there was more that I could do. But all I knew was to teach them the little that I knew, hoping that it might help them against the hardships that lay ahead. And somehow you never forget what poverty and hatred can do when you see its scars on the hopeful face of a young child. I never thought then, in 1928, that I would be standing here in 1965. It never even occurred to me in my fondest dreams that I might have the chance to help the sons and daughters of those students and to help people like them all over this country. But now I do have that chance. And I'll let you in on a secret. I mean to use it.
With memories of those Mexican-American school children seared in his conscience and racial strife alive and well in America in the mid-1960s, LBJ took his own revolution where FDR had not, enlisting in the cause of civil rights and determined to put a legal end to racial apartheid in America. On November 25, 1963, on what was the second full day of his presidency, Johnson called Martin Luther King Jr. and initiated what would become among the most productive and important partnerships of the 20th century.
A good many people told me that they heard about your statement, I guess, on TV, wasn't it?
Yes, that's right.
I've been locked up in this office, and I haven't seen it, but I won't tell you how grateful I am and how worthy I'm going to try to be of all your hopes.
Well, thank you very much. I'm so happy to hear that, and I knew that you had just that great spirit, and you know you have our support and backing.
Well,
we know what a difficult period this is.
It's just an impossible period. We got a budget coming up that's got nothing to do with it. It's practically already made, and we got a civil rights bill that hadn't even passed the House, and it's November, and Hubert Humphrey told me yesterday everybody wanted to go home. We got a tax bill that they haven't touched. We just got to not let up on any of them and keep going, and I guess they'll say that I'm repudiated, but I'm going to ask the Congress Wednesday to just stay there till they pass them all. They won't do it, but we'll just keep them there next year till they do, and we just won't give up an inch.
Well, this is mighty fine. I think it's so imperative. I think one of the great tributes that we can pay in memory of President Kennedy is to try to enact some of the great progressive policies that he sought to initiate.
Well, I'm going to support them all, and you can count on that, and I'm going to do my best to get other men to do likewise, and I'll have to have y'all's help. I never needed more than I do now.
Well, you know you have it, and just feel free to call on us for anything.
Thank you so much, Martin.
All right.
Call me when you... I sure will. Call me when you're down here next time.
I certainly will.
But let's get together, and any suggestions you got, bring them in.
Fine. I certainly will do that.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All men are created equal is an inherent part of the American creed. By working with Martin Luther King and others towards the Civil Rights Acts of 1964 and 1968, the Voting Rights Act of 1965, and other civil rights measures, LBJ, more than any other president, helped to fulfill the promise of equal rights for all Americans. That legislation came at a cost. When Johnson's friend and mentor, Democratic Senator Richard Russell of Georgia, warned him that passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 would result in the Democratic Party's loss in the southern states and his loss of the presidency in the fall election, Johnson replied, "If that is the price for this bill, I will gladly pay it." In fact, the Democrats did lose the South, but Johnson won the election of 1964 in a landslide. He used that mandate to fulfill other promises, enacting Medicare, Head Start, federal aid to education, immigration reform, environmental conservation, and taking measures to weaken poverty's hold in America, as the poverty rate plunged from 20% to 12% during the course of his administration. The Great Society might have swept even further into American life if not for the mire of Vietnam, a conflict Johnson inherited from Presidents Eisenhower and Kennedy. As LBJ escalated the war with no resolution in sight, divisions spread throughout the country. On any given day in the latter part of his presidency, protesters could be heard outside of the White House gates chanting, "Hey, hey, LBJ, how many kids did you kill today?" LBJ agonized over the war, which resulted in the loss of 36,000 U.S. troops by the time he ended his White House reign in 1969. But as this conference will reflect, LBJ's formidable legacy of liberty continues to resonate, uniting us today far beyond the divisions of yesteryear. "Come, let us reason together" was Johnson's favorite biblical passage. By reaching across the aisle, appealing to reason, and fostering togetherness, he not only continued FDR's revolution, but left his own indelible mark on America. While he may have been the consummate politician, his ultimate aim was to use his power to do the greatest good for the greatest number. Hey, hey, LBJ, my oh my, we could use you today. One of Johnson's chief architects in building his great society was a young New Yorker named Joe Califano, who served as a special assistant to the president from 1965 to 1969. He then went on to become Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare for Jimmy Carter. He is currently an advisory board member for the Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute, and as President Raab mentioned, a catalyst for this conference. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming to the stage Joe Califano.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm standing between you and Robert Caro, so I'll be short. Bob Caro is fascinated with the exercise of power and those who exercise it. That fascination led him to write The Power Broker, his brilliant biography of Robert Moses that set a whole new standard for political biography. Today, I view that Pulitzer Prize-winning book as his warm-up for tackling Lyndon Johnson, the most intelligent, complicated, committed, inspiring, and infuriating person I've ever worked for. Bob Caro is Lyndon Johnson's most demanding and meticulous biographer. Bob is fond of saying that, and I quote, "To understand power, you not only have to show how it is used, but also its effect on those on whom it is used. You have to show the effect of power on the powerless." No wonder he has become obsessed with Lyndon Johnson. Bob Caro has worked for 40 years to give the world LBJ with the bark off, his highs and lows, how this president gave new meaning to the word Machiavellian as he gave new hope to the most vulnerable among us. Robert Caro gives no quarter to the subjects he writes about, so we should all take notice of what he wrote about the president in Master of the Senate, his third Johnson volume. In the 20th century, Caro wrote, with its 18 American presidents, Lyndon Baines Johnson was the greatest champion that black Americans and Mexican Americans, and indeed all Americans of color, had in the White House. The greatest champion they had in all the halls of government. He was the lawmaker for the poor and downtrodden and the oppressed. The president who wrote mercy and justice into the statute books by which America was governed, end quote. Bob Caro's three volumes on LBJ have already won him a second Pulitzer Prize and a second National Book Award and too many other prizes and accolades for me to mention in any introduction. Of one thing I'm certain, LBJ has given Bob Caro plenty of material to win even more prizes with his next volume, Passage of Power, about the years from 1958 to 1964, when Johnson was vice president, part of those years, which will be out in May, and with his final volume on the White House years and beyond, due out in a couple of years. Indeed, Publishers Weekly, in the issue coming out on April 1st, has already called his forthcoming volume compelling, insightful, and one that will thrill all those who care about American politics. Bob, he's back there. Bob has spent some 40 years with Lyndon Johnson, and he looks great. Bill Moyers and I spent about 3 years each with him in the White House, and we're still exhausted every time we think about it. Ladies and gentlemen, the great Bob Caro.
Thank you. Joe, that was such a nice introduction that I'm reminded of what Lyndon Johnson used to say when he used to get an especially nice introduction. He used to say he wished his parents were alive to hear it, because his father would have loved it and his mother would have believed it. You know what Winston Churchill said when he was asked where he was in his great biography of Lord Marlborough? He said, "I'm working on the fifth of a projected four volumes." Well, not to equate myself with Winston Churchill, but I'm in the same boat. And in a way, this talk tonight is an explanation of how I got there. The role of government, the responsibilities of government, that's the theme of this symposium, with the focus on Lyndon Baines Johnson, 36th President of the United States. on Lyndon Johnson's concept of what the role of government should be. And that theme will be explored in detail in the panels tonight and tomorrow. But to begin this conference, I am going to talk about the origins of this concept, about its beginnings, about where Lyndon Johnson's belief in the role of government came from, about the most fundamental, basic beginnings for Lyndon Johnson, not the beginnings in Washington, but the beginnings long before Washington. And I'll try to talk also about the origins not only of Lyndon Johnson's general beliefs about the role and responsibility of government, but also about the origins of the program in which, in a way, he announced his beliefs to the American people, about the program in which, just 7 weeks after President Kennedy's assassination, in his first State of the Union address, Johnson enunciated quite clearly his concept of what the role of government should be. It's the program with which he began his great society, the War on Poverty. For Lyndon Johnson, the beginnings are all in the place he came from, the place in which he was born and raised, the Texas Hill Country. I've talked about the Hill Country before, but I don't think you can talk about it too much, particularly in New York City. I saw what that meant growing up there myself, and it was quite a shock. I grew up in New York City, which is this place of fast-paced conversations and busy streets, theaters, and everything else. There was then a 9 o'clock plane from LaGuardia to Austin, and I take that plane, and sometimes when I got off that plane, I felt you'd rent a car, you drive west out of Austin into the Hill Country, and on those days I felt like I was going from one end of the earth to the other. I'll never forget the first time I drove out there, about 40 miles out of Austin, as you're heading towards Johnson City. There's a rise, they call it a round mountain, but it's really just a tall hill. But as I came to the top of it, something made me pull my car over to the side of the road and get out on the shoulder and look down in front of me, because I was looking at something that I had never seen before in my life. It was just emptiness. I was looking at a valley. I later found out it was 42 miles long and about 15 miles across. And when I stood there first and looked at it, I felt that there wasn't a single human thing in it to be seen. Just a tremendous expanse of emptiness. And then something happened, a cloud moved in front of the sun or away from the sun or something. And all of a sudden, there was a light glinting off a little huddle of houses in the middle of that empty space. That was Johnson City, Texas. When Lyndon Johnson was growing up there, the population was 367 at one point. When I came along, it was 362. And I think I had stopped the car then and got out of it because I realized I was confronting something that I'd never seen before and that I really wasn't equipped to deal with. As I started to interview Lyndon Johnson, you know, Lyndon Johnson died so young, at the age of 64, and I came along so quickly after he had died, that all the people who knew him, who grew up with him in Johnson City, they were just about all still there. If his best friend in high school was Truman Fawcett had moved to a bigger house, but it was still in Johnson City, just a couple of blocks away. If his first girlfriend was Kitty Clyde Ross, she was Kitty Clyde Leonard now, but she actually still lived in her parents' house. And I started to learn about this land. You know, the land, now, of course, Austin has pushed out into it. But then the Hill Country began just at the western edge of Austin and rolled west. It encompasses 23,000 square miles, which is an area big enough to put all of New England into it and still have room for Pennsylvania. And the population at that time was about 3 people per square mile. The first settlers called it the land of endless horizons, because every time you got to the top of one line of hills, you found that there was another one beyond it. It was a land of incredible loneliness as I started to talk to people there. I'll never forget Lyndon Johnson's for a large part of Lyndon's boyhood, didn't even live in Johnson City. They lived 18 miles beyond it on the Johnson Ranch. And Lyndon's brother, Sam Houston Johnson, once told me they were so lonely out there that one corner of the ranch came down to what they called the Austin-Fredericksburg Highway, which was really an unpaved just path between Austin and Fredericksburg. And he told me how Lyndon and he would go down and sit on this corner of the fence hour after hour, hoping for one new face to come along so they'd have someone new to talk to. It was a land of almost incredible poverty. There was almost no cash there. You could get a dime from selling a dozen eggs, but you had to go to Marble Falls to sell it. Marble Falls was 22 miles away across the hills. And a friend of Lyndon Johnson's, Ben Kreider, told me how he used to, on Saturdays, ride those 22 miles carrying a dozen eggs in a basket in front of me, carrying them like this so that they wouldn't break. 22 miles like that to get a dime. And I came to realize that being from New York, I simply wasn't understanding. I came back and I told Ina one night, you know, I'm not understanding these people, and I'm not understanding this country, therefore I'm not understanding Lyndon Johnson. Would you mind if we moved here? Ina, of course, said, okay, and for 3 years we rented a house up in the hill country, and I would spend day after day driving around interviewing these people. Every interview seemed to be 180 miles from the one before. interviewing these people who grew up with Lyndon Johnson, went to college with Lyndon Johnson, or were members of his first political machine. When you move to a world, it opens up to you in ways that you can't even imagine. I mean, one thing I had heard, you know, we all heard, if you read about Lyndon Johnson, you cite a wonderful journalist for Time magazine, has a poignant scene in his book on Johnson's presidency. We're following a cabinet meeting. Johnson says, following cabinet meetings, Johnson would often say, you know, I had two Rhodes scholars at the table, all these guys from Harvard, and one graduate of Southwest Texas State Teachers College. Anside, he said, Johnson would always laugh loudly at that, too loudly. And I didn't really understand what Lyndon Johnson's education, the effect that it had on him, until I went down to the college, found the textbooks that they used. And I said, gee, they're like textbooks that you would use in high school in New York. That was his college education. I found a friend of his, a guy named Joe Berry, who later became a professor at Bryn Mawr. He said, you know, when I got to Bryn Mawr, I realized I couldn't talk to anybody about anything. I felt I had been cheated out of an education. So that's part of Lyndon Johnson's upbringing. But it also showed me, living there, just how remarkable were his unique abilities to use the powers of government to improve the lives of people. While I was interviewing in the Hill Country, I came to realize that I was hearing the same thing over and over. They would tell me these stories about Johnson's ruthlessness and his cruelty, often just cruelty for the sake of being cruel. But then I would hear over and over, they would say, no matter what Lyndon was like, we loved him because he brought the lights. Well, brought the lights. Well, I knew what brought the lights meant. I mean, I knew from reading that when Johnson became congressman in 1937 at the age of 28, there was no electricity in the Hill Country. And during his term as congressman, he brought electricity to the Hill Country. But because I came from New York City, where electricity is always just there, you turn a light switch and it's on, I understood intellectually what bringing electricity meant, but I didn't really understand what it meant or what the lives of the people of the Hill Country were like without it. Because they didn't have any electricity, of course, they didn't have movies, they didn't have radio programs. One of the poignant things that they told me was so many of these farmers and ranchers would say, you know, we loved FDR, he saved my ranch, he saved my farm. We heard all about these wonderful fireside chats, but we couldn't hear the fireside chats. The only radios they had in the Hill Country were these crystal sets, and they would describe sitting there while Roosevelt was talking, moving the needle back and forth on the dial, and trying to make his voice come in clearly. But movies and radio are just entertainment. Not having electricity means something a lot deeper than that. You can say it all, you don't have washing machines, etc., but you can say it most basically, perhaps, in water. You know, for us, we just turn a faucet, and because of electric pumps, water comes out. But in the hill country, water came from streams and wells. Now, the streams in the hill country are generally small and dried up for a large part of the year. So they had to get water out of the wells. And the water table in the hill country in general is about 75 feet deep. So they had to dig wells 75 feet and bring up water from it. The Department of Agriculture tells us that at that time, the average farm family used 200 gallons of water each day, or 73,000 gallons, or 300 tons per year. And that water had to be brought up from the wells by the women, by the wives of the house, because the husband was out in the fields working all day. And there was so little cash in the hill country that as soon as the children got old enough to work, boys and girls both, they had to work what they called off the farm, on more prosperous farms in other areas of Texas, nearby areas of Texas, for a dollar a day to earn some cash money. So the woman of the house would be left there alone. I had a hard time getting these women to talk to me at the beginning, because incredibly enough, they were very shy about talking to someone from the city. So Ina, as a matter of fact, learned to make fig preserves, and she would go and become friends with the women, and then I could go back and they would talk to me more freely. And they would say to me, "You're a city boy." She says, "You don't know what bringing the water meant." They would say, and they would go to their attic or their garage, and they'd bring out a bucket of water, often with the rope still attached, frayed old rope attached. And they would take me over to the wells, which were always covered by these boards, and you'd push the boards aside, and they'd say, they'd drop the bucket in, and they'd say, "You're a city boy, you don't know how heavy a bucket of water is. Now pull it up." And of course, a bucket of water, you find out, is heavy to be pulled up. In fact, it was so too heavy for these women often. So what they would do is they had this metal thing over the well, and they put the rope over it, and they do what they call walking away. They'd haul up on the rope like this to pull the bucket of water out of the well. And that's the way they had to bring up all this water that they needed for household duties. Then they would say to me, "You know, it's easier to get it to the house if you do it two buckets at a time. Do you know how we did that?" And I'll never forget the first time a woman went over to the garage and opened it and showed me her yoke, because that's how these women carried the water, with yokes over their shoulders like cattle. You know, I realized that I was hearing another thing. I had been hearing another thing in a lot of these interviews with the women. They would say things like, "Do you see how round-shouldered I am? Do you see how stooped I am? Bent." They would say, "Do you see how bent I am?" The word in the hill country is really bent. "Do you see how bent I am?" And in fact, I had sort of noticed that these women seemed a great deal more stooped than city women. But I thought it was just because they were old. But they would say, "I got bent like this before my time. My back got bent like this when I was young." These women were stooped at 40, stooped at 35. So one woman said to me, "I swore that I wasn't going to look like my mother looked. But then the babies started to come, and I had to bring the water, and I knew I was going to look exactly like my mother looked." They would show me what wash days were like because they didn't have electricity. They would take out four number three zinc wash tubs, and you'd line them up on your lawn, and you'd build a fire under each one, and you transfer. The first one was the lye soap, and they didn't have enough money to buy store-bought soap, so they had to make their own soap out of lye. And there was another expression in the hill country: lye soap peels the skin off your hand like gloves. But you put the first load of wash in, and scrub it out with the lye soap, and then they say, "You're a city boy, you don't know how heavy a load of wet wash is on the end of a broomstick, do you?" And they would give me, and it's very heavy. And then they'd be the lye wash tub, the rinsing wash tub, the bluing or starch washtub and then the other rinsing washtub. So they had to transfer these between the washtubs, and they, on an average day, as near as I could tell, there were 8 to 10 loads of wash in the Hill Country family. And this, I'll never forget how my back hurt on wash days. Tuesday was ironing. I'm not going to bore you all by going through a day of the week. I named that, they called it, I named the chapter after what they called Tuesday, the sad irons. Because you didn't have electricity, an iron was a hunk of metal with a wooden handle, which you would transfer from iron to iron. And you'd have to get them hot on the stove. And that meant you had to stand next to the stove all day doing your ironing. And it's nothing in the Hill Country for it to get up to 105 or 106 degrees, sort of day by day there. So these people were living lives out of the Middle Ages. They were living like peasants. Lyndon Johnson runs for Congress at the age of 28. And he says, if you elect me, I will bring electricity. Well, they elected him. Let me just go back. And Lyndon Johnson was a political genius. And he gears his campaign to the women. And what he said, the line that he uses is, if you elect me, you won't look like your mother does. They elect him, but no one really believes that he can bring electricity. I mean, there is no dam, no source of dam in the Hill Country. A dam has been started at the edge of the Hill Country, but it's the Depression, it's 1937. The company that was doing it has run out of money to do it, and so the dam is stopped. And even if you build a dam, how are you going to get electricity out to these scattered farms? Isolated farms, miles one by one, laying lines across the hill. Well, to watch Lyndon Johnson do that, to watch him do what he had to do to get the dam built, then persuade the Rural Electrification Administration to violate all their rules and lay these lines when I think they had a minimum of like 10 people per mile, or they wouldn't lay lines, but they didn't have that there, but he gets them to do it. Keeps asking Roosevelt for money to build the dam. Every time he sees him, he asks him for money. He has intermediaries, Roosevelt's aides, they're always asking him. And finally, Roosevelt said, oh, give the kid the dam. And electricity comes to the Hill Country, and the people of his 10th congressional district, are brought in a stroke by one man using governmental, he's a genius for government. Brings them into the 20th century. And the fact that he did that means that we see in the Hill Country the beginnings of what I'm talking about, the beginnings of something else in Lyndon Johnson, not just an understanding of what should be done to help people who were fighting forces too big for them to fight themselves. They were never going to get electricity on their own. No private company was going to bring it in there. It wasn't profitable enough. Not just an understanding of what should be done to help people, but the ability to help them. A gift that he had, quite a rare gift, really. A talent that was beyond talent. To use the powers of government to help people trying to fight forces too big for them to fight themselves. You know, his father was a populist legislator, served 6 terms in the Texas House of Representatives. And he used to say that the proper function of government was to help people caught in the tentacles of circumstance. The tentacles of circumstance, fighting things too big for you to help to fight yourself. Joe said that I try to write about the effect of power on the powerless and how power is used on the powerless. Also, you try to write about how power is used for the powerless. Now we go forward to 1963. President Kennedy was assassinated, of course, on November 22nd, and Lyndon Johnson has become president. Under President Kennedy, there had been some vague, hardly defined early discussions about a poverty program, an anti-poverty program, because over one-fifth of the United States, 33 million people actually, in that year, 1963, was still living below the poverty line. On the day after the assassination, on the Saturday, November 23rd, at the end of the day, Lyndon Johnson meets in his office, in the executive office building, he still hasn't moved into the White House, with four of President Kennedy's economic advisors, Walter Heller, who's chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors, Kermit Gordon, the director of the Budget Bureau, Douglas Dillon, the secretary of the Treasury, and Gardner Ackley, whose title escapes me at the moment. He was a deputy to Heller. The meeting is about the budget. Johnson is coming in the middle of the budget process, knowing very little about it, has to get brought up to speed. It's a long meeting, but at the end of the meeting, as Heller is leaving, he's walking out the open door and Lyndon Johnson is beside him. We know what Heller said, and we know what Johnson's response was, because both Heller and Ackley left notes on the meeting, and their notes coincide exactly. Heller mentions the anti-poverty program. Johnson shuts the door. He says, that's my kind of program. I'll find money for it one way or the other. Heller had, up to that point, Johnson had said a lot of things about budget and his various priorities, and Heller had formed an impression, and I'll read from his notes. His other remarks, Johnson's other remarks, he said, was, quote, a little calculated, a play for support. There he was, Lyndon Johnson, the politician, close quote. Not about this, however. Standing at that door, Heller suddenly feels that there was no calculation at all in Lyndon Johnson's response to poverty. That was so spontaneous, so immediate, an instinctive and intuitive and uncalculated response. All his life, people who worked for Johnson for years knew about those moments of instinctive, uncalculated responses, always in response to injustice or social need. Those of you who have read my books know there was a moment like that in 1949 when he learns that a Mexican-American soldier has been killed in the Philippines during World War II, has been denied burial in his South Texas cemetery of the South Texas town because he's not white. On the instant, John Connolly and Walter Jenkins are standing there when Johnson, they hand him the telegram. Johnson reads it, and without a moment's hesitation, he says, by God, we'll bury him in Arlington. All through his life, there are these moments, and here is another one. That Christmas, that December, Johnson goes down for a two-week vacation on his ranch. And Heller finds out that his analysis, his feeling that this was spontaneous, uncalculated, he finds out that that analysis was correct. Johnson is down on the ranch, the Johnson Ranch, the ranch that his father lost and that he has now bought back. And when Heller and Kermit Gordon get there, they find that those words weren't meaningless. Johnson has found new money, $500 million, for an anti-poverty program. And they find he is determined to push it through Congress. He gives them a lesson in political tactics. They had thought of a program as a targeted demonstration program with demonstration programs in a limited number of cities. Johnson says, tries to make them understand that a limited number of districts means that a limited number of congressmen are going to get benefits from that program. And he says in his memoirs, I was certain that we could not start small and propel a program through Congress. He tells them they have to, his quote is something like, I knew we had to do it big or we wouldn't get it through Congress at all. And they see he's very determined. He keeps asking them, how are you going to spend all this money? I've earmarked $500 million to get this program started, but I'll withdraw it unless you fellows come through with something that's workable. Very determined. And when you ask where this determination came from, as always with Lyndon Johnson, part of the explanation is political. He was weak with, he had an election coming up in 10 months. He was weak with liberals, weak in the big cities of the Northeast, in the liberal urban areas. A campaign against poverty would strengthen Johnson in these areas. So part of it is political, as always with Johnson. But as always with Lyndon Johnson, part of the explanation is something more. something that had to do with the fact that when he was doing this, when he was thinking of this anti-poverty program, he was doing it back in the Hill Country where his father had gone broke and he had grown up in poverty, back in the ranch, back at his beginnings. How do we know that those beginnings were very much in his mind as he's dealing with the anti-poverty program that Christmas? Well, he talks very often during those weeks about his boyhood and about a particular thing in his boyhood, having to get up early. Most of the books on Johnson quote a very cute remark that he made to reporters as he's flying down to the ranch. He says, "I've always been an early riser. My daddy used to come to my bedroom at 4:30 in the morning when I was working on the highway gang right out of high school, and he'd twist my big toe real hard so he hurt. And he'd say, 'Get up, Lyndon. Every other boy in town's got a half hour's head start on you.'" That's sort of cute. But there's nothing really cute about other things he said about being poor. I was interviewing an old Hill Country ally of his, a guy named E. Babe Smith, who went back a long way with Lyndon Johnson. He recalls him saying, he calls him early one morning and he says he hopes he hasn't woken him up. Then he says, "I'm sure I haven't, because you were a poor boy too. And therefore you must have been getting up all your life just like me." This is the quote. "That's the only way we can keep up," he said. "Otherwise, they're too far ahead of us." Calls an attorney in Fredericksburg who's known since his boyhood, man named Arthur Staling, and says, "We always get up early, don't we?" When Staling answers the phone on the first ring, "We can't make it unless we do." At the age of 9 and 10, Lyndon Johnson had worked in the cotton fields beside his cousin, Ava, hauling cotton on their knees all day under the broiling Hill Country sun. I asked, that Christmas, we know from the diary, the backup diary that the aides kept, that the presidential aides keep, that Johnson and Lady Bird visit Ava in Johnson City to bring her a poinsettia for Christmas, and I asked Ava if she remembered what they had talked about, and she said she didn't, except that she was sure that they had talked about the cotton picking. She said whenever she and Lyndon got together, the subject of cotton came up. "We always talked about the cotton," she said. "We just hated that so much." Hate is a word that occurs very frequently when people talk about Lyndon Johnson's feelings about poverty. In a memoir that was written by his longtime cardiologist, Dr. Willis Hurst, Dr. Hurst writes that he hated poverty and illiteracy. He hated it, it's in italics. He hated it when a person who wanted to work could not get a job. And then he recounts an incident that occurred when he was accompanying Johnson during his vice presidency on a trip to Iran. And they pass a group of Iranian children, and somebody remarks that they have rags for clothing. And Johnson flies into a rage and says, as Hearst recalls it, "Don't say that. I know rags when I see them. They had patched clothes. That's a lot different from rags." And I suddenly remembered, when I read this reminiscence of Dr. Hearst, something that Lyndon's brother, Sam Houston Johnson, had told me about them growing up. And I couldn't quite recall, which is why I didn't quote it exactly in the book, but only in general. I hadn't thought to take a note of it at the time, but I remember Sam Houston saying something like, when he was describing their poverty, that he and his sister Rebecca had to wear patched clothes. And I remember he said something to me like, "But they weren't rags." So these are the beginnings of Lyndon Johnson on the anti-poverty program, the war on poverty. And you know how much the war on poverty meant to Lyndon Johnson if you just listen to the words with which he introduced the war on poverty in that first State of the Union speech when he flew back to Washington from the ranch to deliver it on January 8, 1964. The writing of the speech is interesting in that regard. Johnson had persuaded Ted Sorensen, the great speechwriter for John F. Kennedy, to stay on at least for a while and help him with his speeches, a short while. And he had flown Sorensen and his three little boys down to Texas, and they were staying at the Lewis Ranch, which is some miles away from the Johnson Ranch. His little boys, Sorensen's little boys, his dad was supposed to spend time with us that Christmas, but all we remember is him scribbling in this little room at the end of the hall. Several evenings he went down to the ranch house talking to Johnson about the speech. But when you analyze those drafts, and you can see them in the Johnson Library draft by draft, Sorensen draft one, Sorensen draft two, you see how much of it came from Johnson. Some of it, when he delivers the speech, are real Lyndon Johnson words. Sorensen had written, "This administration declares unconditional war on poverty in America." The speech is delivered by Lyndon Johnson is, "This administration today, here and now, declares unconditional war on poverty in America." He had added four words, "today, here and now," Lyndon Johnson words. And the speech said, "Unfortunately, many Americans live on the outskirts of hope, some because of their poverty and some because of their color, and all too many because of both. Our task is to help that one-fifth of all American families with incomes too small to even meet their basic needs. Our chief weapons will be better schools and better health and better homes and better training and better job opportunities to help more Americans, especially young Americans, escape from squalor and misery and unemployment rolls." You know, it's interesting to watch that speech on tape today. As Lyndon Johnson says those three words, squalor, misery, unemployment, his eyes behind the thick glasses he had to wear for speeches narrow. And I wrote, his lips, set already in that grim, tough line, tightened and twisted into an expression close to a snarl. And he continued with words that, while none of them applied specifically to the circumstances of his own life, might nevertheless have had a special resonance for someone who had grown up in poverty and who knew it was only because he hadn't been given a fair chance. And of course, Lyndon Johnson passed the war on poverty, passed so many of the other bills that will be discussed during the rest of this symposium. He showed in his presidency, he demonstrated in his presidency what he had demonstrated as a young congressman, a rare gift, a talent beyond talent, a talent that was genius for transmuting compassion into government action. To transmute compassion into government action that would make the compassion meaningful. The life of Lyndon Johnson is a very complicated life, but two aspects of it shine through all the complications, shine brightly through all the dark episodes. One is the compassion, the sympathy for, the empathy for people, poor people, people of color, people caught in the tentacles of circumstance. And the other is the great gift, the talent beyond talent, to make compassion meaningful. Meaningful how? To help people fight forces too big for them to fight alone. The proper role of government. And as I said at the beginning of my talk, it all went back to the beginning. Now, I may have talked too long, but if I could write short, I wouldn't always be writing 1,000-page books. Thank you.
Fantastic. It's now my pleasure to introduce this extraordinary panel. They're supposed to flash some pictures up here. The guy with all the hair, that's me. A few years ago, so I don't have to introduce myself. Maybe they can run those. And that's, yeah, there we are. Okay. And the next one is Irvin Duggan. Right there. He still has a lot of hair. It's a little gray, but Irv, come on out. Irv was one of Johnson's aides. He left the Washington Post to come work at the White House on education and welfare and civil rights. He was a commissioner of the FCC, Federal Communications Commission, for 5 years, 6 years as president and CEO of the Public Broadcasting System. And now he is president and CEO of the Society for Four Arts in Palm Beach. And if you ever go to Palm Beach, you should look him up. That's an incredible operation he's got down there. Senator George McGovern, my God. A World War II bomber pilot who received the Distinguished Flying Cross for his heroism, a history teacher, a member of the House. He was elected senator in 1962, opposed the war in Vietnam vigorously. He was a Democratic candidate for president in 1972. Actually, I got to know him best then. I was the counsel for the Democratic Party then. George called me one day and from South Dakota when his vice presidential candidate, Tom Eagleton, had gotten into trouble and said, how do you change, how do you change the candidate for vice president? I said, I don't know. He said, well, you better find out. You're my lawyer. he left the Senate, stayed in the Senate in 1980. He's done lots of work on food for peace. And this July, if I'm right, George, you will celebrate your 90th birthday, 90 years young. Walter Mondale, Vice President of the United States under Jimmy Carter. God, don't we wish we had men like that in Washington today? I got to know, he was Attorney General of Minnesota, then he was appointed senator in 1964 to take Hubert Humphrey's place when LBJ was elected president, Humphrey vice president. 1966, he was elected in his own right. He was a Democratic Party nominee for president in 1984, ambassador to Japan for 4 years in the 1990s. He is still practicing law in Minneapolis, and when he was vice president, I think it's fair to say that no one was more responsible for my getting the job as secretary of HEW than you were. Sorry. wonderful, wonderful man. Bill Moyers. Probably, Bill. One of our country's most prolific and respected journalists, 35 Emmys, a 40-year run on public broadcasting with a new series this year. I think it's Moyers and Company. He helped organize the Peace Corps. He was press secretary and a confidant, a close confidant of LBJ, publisher of Newsday, a best-selling author. And, you know, when Bill called me, I was working in the Pentagon, when Bill called me and said, you know, you got to come over here and work in the White House. And I said, well, he said, no, he said, it'll be fun. Bill, I never knew what fun was until I started working for Lyndon Johnson. and last, our moderator, Bob Schieffer. He is the CBS News Chief and Chief Washington Correspondent. Moderator of Face the Nation. All of you who rue the fact that Face the Nation is only half an hour, it is going to an hour beginning in April, and we look forward to that, Bob. He's covered all four major Washington beats, the White House, the State Department, the Pentagon, and Capitol Hill. I think he's proudest of all, he said once, of the fact that his university, Texas Christian University, has named their School of Journalism the Schieffer School of Journalism. We have, I'll turn it over to Bob, but first, this is Lyndon Johnson talking to Everett Dirksen about an excise tax problem he has. I'll kind of give you a sense of what it was like.
Now, you're not going to beat me on excise taxes and ruin my budget this year. I've got ways and means holding hearings, and we're going to come up with a recommendation one way or the other. But don't beat me on that now. You can do it if you want to, and you can ruin my budget, but you're hollering the economy and trying to balance it. Now, cut the deficit 50% under what Kennedy had it. Now, if you screw me up on excise taxes and get that thing going, I'll have hell. Now, let my Ways and Means Committee...
Now, look at the pressure I'm under.
Now, you're not under...
Trade Association.
Well, I know it, but God, you also for good fiscal prudence, and you know that the way to do this is through the House Committee, and you know if you put it in, you're not going to get it. They're not going to let you all write a bill over in the Senate on taxes, you know. Now, please don't press me on that. Well, who are you going to take? You going to take all your Republicans? Give me one or two of them, and let them be prudent. You've got people on there that can...
Well, you got enough votes to beat
me. No, I haven't. You can beat me, and you want to do it. And you see how you're going to let me win by one vote, and then I'll call you back in a little bit on that.
You never talked that way when you were sitting in that front seat.
Yeah, well, I did if my country's involved. I voted for Ike one time. When Nolan voted against him, I cast the vote on his foreign aid and brought it out of the committee.
You're a hard bargainer.
And no, I'm not. But you just take care of me, and I'll look at this and see what I can do and call you right back.
All right.
Well, I think the first question to ask at this gathering here of this distinguished group, Joe Califano, do you think anybody talks on the telephone to anybody else in Washington like that today?
No. I don't think there's anything like that at all. I mean, it was rare. It was rare even in those days, but it was nobody talking like him.
I just reread Harry McPherson's book. Harry McPherson was an aide to Lyndon Johnson. It's a wonderful book. And he has in there, at one point, he said, Lyndon Johnson could deliver because he had a firm working relationship with Republican leaders. He said, the bolder, the more sweeping, the more complex the program that a president submits to Congress, the more necessary it is that he and his helpers practice the non-intellectual art of personal politicking with men and women of both parties. He says the grasp of the issues and the facility of expression are seldom sufficient to get the job done. And it seems to me, I wonder, and I just want to talk to each of you today, has Washington lost the ability to negotiate? Have they lost the ability to make a deal? It's not that way anymore. Joe, why don't we just go around the horn here?
Well, I think they have lost the ability to make a deal. And I think it's, I think Senator Govern can certainly talk about it. Even when he was virtually calling for Johnson to get out of the White House, was still talking to him about food stamp programs and everything else. I mean, I think we've lost that. And just one example, I mean, my recollection, Bill can check me, but was fundamentally, he said, you know, you treat Everett Dirksen, who was the minority leader in the Senate, the same way you treat Mike Mansfield. You treat Gerry Ford, same way you treat Speaker McCormick. They want something, you help them. We need them. We need them. And, you know, those bills, those civil rights bills, never could have happened without Republican votes. And lots of other bills never could have happened. And he also used to say, with respect to Medicare, it's a complicated piece of legislation. If we don't have half the Republicans, we'll never get these health care bills, all these complicated bills through, because they'll beat us in the states, they'll beat us in the appropriations committees, their guys in the corporations will beat us. So he inculcated us with that.
Well, you mentioned Senator McGovern. Talk about that a little bit, Senator, because you were on the end of the other end of a lot of it. I mean, you were against the war. You fought him. It was an epic battle. But yet, he still kept a part of that relationship sort of compartmentalized, didn't he? Because he needed you on a couple of things.
Well, before I ran for president, I had been hammering our Vietnam involvement for 10 years. I finally decided that the Senate's a great place, but one senator from a small populated state like South Dakota is not going to have much impact on a national policy such as a war. And I called up the White House, and Bill Moyers took my call. And I said, do you think you could arrange for me to see the president? And without thinking about it too long, he said, yes, you can. You want to come tonight about 7 o'clock? The very same night, I thought he'd say it'd be a week or so before we can get to you. But that was the way the Johnson White House functioned. It's the way the president functioned. So I walked in there that night. It was the first time I had been in the Oval Office. And I have to confess, I was kind of overwhelmed with the atmosphere. And Johnson was a big man. He got up and he took hold of both of my lapels here. And he stood up. He was 2 or 3 inches taller than I was. He's got his head way back like this. I was looking right up his nostrils. And I learned later this was called the nostril treatment. And he said, now, George, I know why you're here to talk to me. I had Joe Rao in here the other day, and he wants me to just pull out of there today. Get our troops out of there. You know I can't do that. Then I have Scoop Jackson in here, and he thinks we ought to bomb the hell out of him. And I can't do that. So I'm just following a common sense middle course. I'm trying to honor the troops that are there. I'm trying to keep in mind that the standing of the United States in the world is on the line, and we just can't surrender to a bunch of little communists out there in Vietnam. It was difficult for me to speak after that, but I said, well, Mr. President, I have a memorandum here. I don't want to take too much of your time, but I'd like to leave that with you. It kind of reviews the history of how we got in there. It also tells what happened to the French. They had the best army in Europe in Vietnam, and they got whipped by those miserable communists out there. And he said, I can't either throw bombs at them or I can't pull out. I'm just trying to follow a middle course. I said, well, maybe you can look over my remarks. He said, George, God darn it, don't give me another memorandum. I got a drawer full of memorandums from Bill Fulbright and Mike Mansfield and God knows how many else. And I don't have time for history right now. I've got boys out there on the front line that are dying, that are fighting for their country. I can't sit around here reading history lessons. So I thought I wasn't communicating very well, and I thanked him for listening to me, and I left. But he never held my opposition to the war against me. Do you think he did, Bill? You were in the White House then.
No, you were exceptional.
Right after I won the presidential nomination in 72, I called him and said, we'd like to come down to Texas and see you. And Sarge Shriver, who was one of my vice presidents went down with me, and they met us at the plane. We landed right at the ranch, and the president and Lady Bird were each driving a golf cart. Sarge went with Lady Bird, and I went with the president. We went up to the house, and it was a delightful experience. He said, "Now let's get one thing clear, George. You think I'm crazy for keeping us in Vietnam all these years. I didn't start that war, but I'm expected to finish it. And I know you think I'm goofy on it. I think you are. So let's not talk about Vietnam." And he gave me some good advice. He said, "George, if I were you, you've been a great critic of your government the last 10 years. If I were you, I would announce for president, telling the country how much they have done for you and how much the United States government means to you. Tell them about your war days. Tell them about what you, as a junior senator from South Dakota, the debt you feel to the people of the United States." You know, he couldn't have given me better advice. I'm sorry that other things crowded in, and I didn't stick with that routine very much, but I should have. I think I'd have gotten more votes. I might have carried two states instead of one.
Bill Moyers, what was it like to just work for Lyndon Johnson?
You had to run just to stay up when he was walking. He never stopped. He was consuming in his passions and his objectives and demanding, but he never asked more of us than he gave himself. It took 12 of us, 10 of us, I think there were in the White House to just keep up with him. He was 13, as I've said before, of the most interesting, complicated men I have ever met. And playing his moods and reading them and trying to integrate them and advance an agenda that all of us had a part of was really a demanding task. It was exhilarating, it was exhausting, it was rewarding, and it was sometimes punishing. But you always were satisfied that the result made the effort worthwhile.
Evan, how did he know so much? I mean, he seemed to know everything about everybody.
Well, J. Edgar Hoover helped him. He was a sponge of political intelligence. Today, big controversy over these political intelligence firms that look for the intelligence. Lyndon Johnson got it in the normal course of his business. He had the three teletype machines in his office, the three television sets in his office. He talked incessantly to people. You thought when he was talking, he was only talking, but not. He was listening to your responses and to the silence between the sentences of your response. And he always knew other people's price, other politicians' price. For some, it was a dinner at the White House. For some, it was a signed photograph for a mother-in-law. For others, it was a dam. He once said to Frank Church, senator from Idaho, who he never forgave the way he did you for opposing him, when Senator Church tried to tell him what to do about Vietnam, and started quoting Walter Lippmann, then the prominent columnist of the day, LBJ said, "I'll tell you what, Frank, the next time you want a dam on the Snake River, you go talk to Walter Lippmann." On the original point, I spent more time at his instruction with Republicans than I did with Democrats, because he knew, as you said, he was going to need those votes. And Judith and I, we worked together on our broadcast, and we were screening a small clip the other day from the signing of the 1964 Act, Civil Rights Act, to which Walter was the floor manager and delivered. And when he finished signing that act with all of the pins, one would have thought, I thought, standing in the back of the room, he would take the first pin and hand it to Martin Luther King. He didn't. He took the first pen and handed it to Everett Dirksen. That was Everett Dirksen's reward for doing what Lyndon Johnson persuaded him, thought he persuaded him to do in that phone call. He understood the importance. You ask about Washington today, President Obama does not enjoy personal persuasion. He doesn't like other politicians. At least that's the impression I get as a journalist. I don't know him personally. Lyndon Johnson did. And he also did not have a party of no. The Republican Party today is not the party that we confronted and ran against in 1964. It's a party of no. So much rhetoric has poisoned people's attitudes toward the government that it's to the Republican Party's interest to make government inefficient so that they can use it to gain power. We didn't have that. There were still, even on the most of the Republican side, Burke Hickenlooper even from Iowa, people like that, a desire to make government work, even though they wanted a smaller government than we did. And there was that feeling that government needed to deliver. And he exploited that, knowing that they had that in common. That isn't the case today. And you know that better than anybody.
Let me ask you, Evan, you were a young staffer working for him. We know he liked FDR and sort of almost thought of him as his father. But who were his role models?
Well, I asked him once in the closing months of the administration, we were flying to Texas, and there wasn't as much to do, and we had more time to talk. And I asked him on the plane, what other politician, Mr. President, other than yourself, do you most admire? I phrased it carefully. And I expected that he would say Richard Russell of Georgia. I expected that he would say FDR, who clearly, there was an umbilical link between the two of them. I expected he might say Mr. Sam Rayburn. Without hesitation, he said, the most skilled politician I ever knew in Washington was Dwight D. Eisenhower. And he began talking about Eisenhower's political genius, which was a revelation to me. And he said, who do you think the first person was that I called from Air Force One after the assassination, on the second person after I called Rose Kennedy? I called Eisenhower. And I said, I haven't been elected in this terrible tragedy. I don't know what to do. I want you to come to Washington right away and give me advice. And he said, Eisenhower came down from Gettysburg. And he said, Mr. President, I'm a military man. I give advice in writing. And my secretary, Ann Whitman, is in retirement in an apartment on Connecticut Avenue. Let her come down, and I will dictate to you, while you go to the events of the funeral, I'll dictate my advice. And President Johnson said, the advice that he wrote in that memo became the script for the first 100 days of my presidency. And he said, during that entire time, when Eisenhower advised me to speak to a joint session of the Congress and make that my inaugural address, to call business leaders together and show the unity of the business community, all these things Eisenhower recommended. Take the Kennedy program and make it a memorial to the slain president. He said, during all the time that I was following the script, my approval ratings were way up in the 70s. And he said, when I came to the last page of the script and it ended, my approval ratings went down to 50. But I thought it was amazing that, and an example of this bipartisanship that you've heard other people on this panel talking about, that he selected a Republican president as the most skilled politician he had known.
That's a new story. I'd never heard that
before. Two quick points on that. In 1954, when I was a summer employee on his staff, I was 20 years old, a clerk in the mailroom of no significance. But he called me over and insisted that I go to an Eisenhower press conference, the first press conference I'd ever seen of a president. And he said, I can't remember the exact quote, but it was, he said, you watch President Eisenhower. He knows how to get what he wants by not appearing to want it. And Johnson was partly that way. Then on the night we flew back from Dallas after the tragedy there and went to the executive office building where the vice president had his suite, the first call he asked me to make was to Dwight Eisenhower, and he allowed me to listen to that conversation. And again, after that conversation was over, he said, "Oh, amazing man," he said, he just understood how you could get what you want by not appearing to want it. Twice he said that.
Senator Mondale, I'm really struck by what I'm hearing here. Here was a man who called people when he needed help and was not afraid to say, I really need some help here. I really need you to help me. You're kind of, you can talk about both of these worlds. How is, and Bill touched on this, how is Washington today different from what it was in those days?
Well, I think Bill touched on it. I would say depressed about it. I was there in the Senate, young man, replaced Humphrey, who became the vice president. Johnson was in his honeymoon period. He had this wonderful program of social justice that I believed in and believe in today. And he was using his energy and his strength, we talked about, to keep the system moving. And he did it on a bipartisan basis. Don't forget that about 20 Democrats were Southerners. And most of them were committed to discrimination, and that was the center of their political careers. A lot of good people there, but that was the reality. So in order to get progressive legislation passed, the numbers told you, unless you could do it on a bipartisan basis, forget it. So everything we did there, and Johnson was leading, Hubert was in there, and the rest, began with how can we make this a bipartisan program? Every civil rights bill of any significance ended up in Dirksen's office. If you wanted a Civil Rights Act, sooner or later, you went to see Dirksen, and if he'd sign on, you could pass it. If he wouldn't, he wouldn't. I remember I handled fair housing, and it looked finally they were going to pass it, and Phil Hart said to me, what can I do for you? I said, well, I'd like my name on this bill, you know, so I can tell the folks back home I'm getting something done. He said, can't do that. I said, why not? He said, Dirksen's name goes on the bill. and that's how we got things done. Now it seems to me that whole dialogue, everything is a train wreck. There is no sense of getting things done or serving broader purposes, and we got to do something about it. Johnson did in his time. I don't think it's being done now.
Well, what happened? What caused this change, Evan?
I think what we've seen over the years is what might be called the emptying out of the center. Richard Scammon, who was President Kennedy and President Johnson's census director, used to say that the game of politics in America is played between the 45-yard lines. And if you stray into the end zones, you lose support. The Congress of the United States today has emptied out the space between the 45-yard lines, and everybody on both sides is clustered in the end zones. And solutions happen in the center. Solutions happen when people between the 45-yard lines get together and work things out. Practical people. I had a young lawyer working for me at the FCC who once observed that political agnostics are the ones who get things done in Washington, those who are not ideologically so committed to one side or another that they cannot compromise. Mm-hmm. And those political agnostics who simply love the process, who love the idea of solving problems together, get together, and they're not so ideologically divided, they can find solutions together. We've had an emptying out of the center and a filling up of the extremes, mm-hmm. both in the country and in the Congress, and I think that's the change.
Well, Joe, I mean, compromise has now become a dirty word. Compromise is something that will get you beat when you run for Congress now. If
sure.
you say, I'm willing to.
And you have to give, and we certain, God knows we gave. But I think there are a couple other things. I think there was real focus. I mean, I don't think any of us had any doubt about where Johnson wanted to go, what he wanted to get done. Civil rights was an overarching issue. He was going to get it done. Whatever other diversions there were, the war on poverty that was mentioned earlier, or the health bills, or what have you. And I think he also knew how to grab an opportunity. I mean, even the grimmest opportunity. We proposed civil rights in 1966. Nothing happened. 67. Nothing happened. Finally, in early 68, he managed to get it out of the Senate. Fair Housing Bill, I'm sorry. Finally managed to get the Fair Housing Bill out of the Senate. It was impossible to move it in the House. may recall, Emanuel Seller, the congressman from Brooklyn, Jewish district with blacks moving in, didn't want to touch the bill. Martin Luther King is assassinated. I will never forget this. It was an awful night. The next morning, before the, he invited all the black leaders in from all across the country to sit around that cabinet table that morning. But he said to me, we're going to get our civil rights bill. Give me a draft of a letter to Speaker McCormick. If we get nothing else, we'll get our fair housing bill now. He sent a letter to the Speaker that morning. And he sent a letter to Jerry Ford. He said, we've got to do this. Then we had to find a floor manager. He knew Seller wouldn't take it. Peter Rodino. Talked Peter Rodino into taking the bill on the floor. Peter Rodino, we passed the fair housing bill within a month. Peter Rodino, incidentally, almost lost re-election in Newark in 1968 because he was a floor manager for that bill. He barely won. But then years later, as he had one black primary opponent after another, he kept beating them because of what he did on the fair housing bill. And the other thing, let me just, Bill knows this. I mean, he had a phenomenal sense of humor. I mean, I think back to those awful riots after the King assassination. I would keep bringing him reports from the FBI, one city after another. We had to bring in troops, and we kept doing that. And then I got this message about Stokely Carmichael. And it was a report. I brought it over to the mansion. Johnson read it. Said Stokely Carmichael is organizing a mob at the corner of 14th and U Streets to march on Georgetown and burn it down. Well, Georgetown was where all these columnists and TV commentators that were driving Johnson crazy lived. And Johnson looked at it, read it. He said, God damn, I've waited 35 years for this night.
Two other quick points on that.
Senator McGovern was just wanting to say something.
I just want to say that as a critic on the Vietnam issue, that before I went into politics, I was a history professor. Do you believe that, Fritz?
Yeah, I do.
Anyway, I used the GI Bill to go all the way through Northwestern University to a PhD in history. And I think, just thinking about what Johnson did on civil rights, what he did on poverty, what he did on education, all these other things, that whole Great Society program, is those were good ideas. Some people ridicule the Great Society. Why would you ridicule a president who was trying to build a great society in the United States? I thought every point in that program made America stronger, and if we'd have gotten the whole thing in full force, it would have made us even stronger. I honestly believe, and I'm speaking now as an old history prof, that with the exception of Roosevelt, who had four terms in the White House, I think Lyndon Johnson was the greatest president of the 20th century.
Senator, let me ask you one thing. Do you think that had Kennedy not gone to Vietnam, do you think that had it to do over, do you think Lyndon Johnson would have gone to Vietnam?
Well, I can only say this. I never knew during all that debate time about Vietnam that President Johnson knew that we made a dreadful mistake getting involved in Vietnam militarily. You read a brilliant historian who's on the program tomorrow, Mr. Beschloss, who's written a book, not so much written a book, but published a book on the Johnson tapes. I didn't even know that Johnson had a tape recorder going either. I thought that was just Nixon. But anyway, here's the tapes, and he's talking to Richard
Russell.
Richard Russell of Georgia, who is chairman of the Senate Formulations Committee, and this is in the first days when President Johnson was sworn in after John Kennedy's assassination. In those first days, he said, "Dick, what the hell are we going to do about that mess out there in Vietnam? We never should have gotten into that place." And Dick Russell, who I also didn't know was felt the same way about it, he says, "I agree. It's a mess. I don't know how you get out of there now. Maybe one thing you could do, you could find those guys out there in Saigon that got rid of old Diem, who was assassinated, and get that gang to send a communique to us asking us to leave." And he said, "Maybe if our so-called allies out there are asking us to leave," but he says, "I don't know how you get that done." Well, he went on at some time about it. Dr. Breslitz can give more on this, but Lyndon Johnson understood perfectly everything I knew about Vietnam, everything Fulbright knew, everything Mike Mansfield knew, but he didn't know how, as a sitting president of the United States, to get out of there without looking like he was the first president to surrender in a war. And he was very proud of America. He was proud of our country, and he had great feeling. He was very proud of the United States government, not like these crazy extreme right-wingers that are assailing the federal government day and night on television, wherever they can be heard. Lyndon Johnson loved the United States government. He loved the Senate. He loved the House of Representatives under Sam Rayburn. He admired the Supreme Court. He loved the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, the whole shebang. And he just didn't want to surrender under those conditions. Well,
Bill, you were about to.
You feed into what I was going to say a moment ago about what has changed. He was a master parliamentarian. He would have been terrific in the House of Parliament, I think. And he was a great majority leader. That's when I spent some of my time, early time, with him. And he understood procedure, respected procedure. Yes, politics is improvisation. It's scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. But it's also about procedure. And that's changed. When Richard Russell, who was his Dutch uncle, he was much closer to LBJ than LBJ was to FDR. When Richard Russell was beginning to mount a filibuster on the civil rights legislation, LBJ asked him to come down to the White House. And he called me on the phone in my office and said, "Bring me a copy of the Constitution." So I didn't know why, but I took him a copy of the Constitution, and he asked me to stay. And he also said, "Put less scotch in my drink than you put in Richard Russell's," which I did. And so when Russell was ratcheting up his argument about why he had to lead a filibuster, LBJ handed him the Constitution. He said, "Dick, go through that." Russell said, "I've read that, Mr. Barrett. I know what's in the Constitution." He said, "No, I'm serious. Go through it. See, point out to me how many times it mentions the filibuster." The Constitution does mention the filibuster once. One of the great differences is today we only needed 51 votes to pass historic pieces of legislation. You can't do it now. You've got to get 60 in order to get to a vote on it. And that's changed, and the Republicans have been masters of that, and the Democrats to some extent. But the other thing that he understood very keenly is that it wasn't only procedure, it was understanding what the other fella, no, it was understand. The other big change, Bob, has been, and I watch you on your show and I see you trying to rationalize with these guys, the delusional has come in from the margin and now occupies centers of power in the Republican Party. We had a great time running against Goldwater in 64 because the right was then funny. It was humorous. And most of our commercials in the 64 campaign were humorous commercials. Today, those delusional people are running one of the two major parties in this country. And there's no rationality with them. There's no reasoning with them. They have an obstinate vision that they pursue, irrespective of the facts. And you cannot ultimately run a government based on delusion.
Senator Mondale.
Good point.
We've talked about how Lyndon Johnson operated when he was the majority leader, but you were in the Senate when he was president. What was it like there? I mean, how did you feel his presence? Tom Johnson, who's sitting out here in the audience, told me one time that Johnson had the name and the phone number of every single member of Congress on his desk, and he called people directly. And he said, you know, when it was a big issue, he'd have Cardinal Cushing calling the Catholics, he'd have Billy Graham calling the Baptists, and he'd have Jack Valenti to try to call the Pope if he thought that would help. But what was it like to be in the Senate? I mean, were you ever on the other end when Johnson needed something and maybe you weren't quite ready to give it to him? Or?
Well, I called him several times with things I wanted. Uh-huh. And I was always prepared because I knew he was busy and I didn't want to take up too much of his time. And every time he'd talk so long, I began to worry about my time. And he never gave me a damn thing. We just conversation. But I was honored to be talked to that way. I've got one story that Joe knows about. I was handling fair housing on the Senate floor. We had 5 cloture votes, and in those days you needed 67 votes if everybody was there. And on the 5th cloture vote, Mike Manson said, "This is your last one now. You've taken up a month here. There's no more time." And we were one vote short. We were almost sick. We just couldn't get that one vote. So I went to Hubert and I said, "What do I do?" He said, "Call the president." So I called President Johnson. I think I got him in Puerto Rico.
We're in Puerto Rico.
I explained my situation and I said, "You know, there's a senator up there in Alaska, Bob Bartlett, who never votes for cloture, but he could. It wouldn't hurt him on this one. But he doesn't want to, but he also wants an auditorium in Anchorage." And the phone clicked off. He stopped talking to me. And Bob Bartlett voted for cloture the next morning. And a month later, there was an announcement at this new auditorium in Anchorage.
What was his relationship like with Humphrey after Humphrey?
It was...
Because I know you were very close to Humphrey.
Yeah, you know, Hubert and I loved Hubert. And I was thrilled when he became vice president. And I would say, in retrospect, he'd been better off if he hadn't been vice president. Yeah. I think he had a great career in the Senate. Everybody loved him. He was... This was really tough. He wrote a memo to then President Johnson as the new vice president, warning him about the war in Vietnam. It's one of the most prescient, carefully reasoned, possible documents for the president to read. And the president took it as an insult and froze Humphrey out of any meaningful involvement in the Johnson administration for the better part of a half a year. It was very painful. And Humphrey felt it deeply. And I'm afraid Humphrey went around and tried to even do better at supporting the war to try to get back into the president's graces. And Humphrey writes about that in his own autobiography. It's really a painful couple of pages. And I don't think Humphrey loved Johnson, but I don't think he ever got over that treatment.
You know,
I'll tell one story. He, in order to get an airplane to fly the vice president, Humphrey'd have to send a note in to Johnson and say, "I need an airplane for this," and then 2 blocks, yes or no on there. And sometimes the letter would come back, no. No explanation. So this sort of thing was painful.
He was a man capable of grand gestures and small cruelties.
Yeah.
And you know, on Humphrey, he told a story once. He said, you know, the difference between Humphrey and me, who's sitting in the rocker. He said, Walter Reuther had come in and said, you know, if you don't find a way to rebuild the cities, we're going to burn the cities down. And it was a tough meeting the president had with Reuther. He said, Walter Reuther comes in here to see Hubert and says, if you don't do something, we're going to burn the cities down. And he said, Reuther, the head of the United Auto Workers, who had a crippled hand because he'd been shot during a demonstration, always kept his right hand in his pocket. And he said, Hubert keeps smiling while Reuther's talking, and he's trying to figure out, how can I get Walter Reuther to take his hand out of his pocket so I can shake hands with him? He says, Reuther comes in here and tells me, well, all we're doing, if we don't find a way to rebuild the cities, we're going to burn them down. He said, I'm sitting here, I'm smiling, I'm looking at that hand, I'm trying to get his hand out of his pocket so I can cut his balls off. He said, that's the difference between Hubert and me.
But I think we have to point out, though, that the relationship between a president and a vice president is an inherently difficult relationship. Here is someone who is waiting for you to exit the stage, someone who may have been your rival, someone who may have been equally distinguished in public life. Barbara Bush complained that the Reagans had never invited the Bushes to a state dinner in the White House. Al Gore and Bill Clinton were rumored to have a certain amount of friction in their relationship. It is an inherently difficult relationship, and I think presidents are interested, in spite of the better angels of their nature, in keeping the vice president somewhat humbled. So he may have been unique in his skill at keeping people humbled, but he was not unique in the desire.
Let me ask
him. He was humble, Bill. You would have known better.
Sure. Well, I don't think
Johnson was humbled when he was Kennedy's vice president.
Oh yeah.
I mean, I was in the Pentagon in those years, and I remember Bill can tell me. I was serviced the White House. That's how I met Bill and Jack Valenti and all those guys. But I was told one day, Valenti called and said, you know, anything that the vice president asks for, I mean, I'm sorry, Kenny O'Donnell called and said, anything the vice president asks for from the Pentagon, you've got to clear it here. Anything, you know, a plane ride, an extra aides or what have you. And I thought, well, you know, when Johnson becomes president, having been subjected to that, it'll be another world. And it was a very short time before Valenti called with the same instruction. But you lived in those vice presidential years.
Yes, but I had left to help organize the Peace Corps. Yeah. I was close to Shriver, whose deputy I became, and I didn't have that much exposure to LBJ during that period of time. I would get it reflected from Shriver sometimes.
Well, I think we'll read a lot about
let
it.
Let me just ask anybody who can add to this while we're on the Humphrey thing. I was at the 1968 convention. It's always been my sense that Johnson really wanted the convention to draft him, and had they have done that, that he would have come back and run for president. Senator Mondale, what's your thought?
Well, those of us supporting Humphrey thought exactly that. The convention was one night, the big night was his birthday, and if the convention had decided to go for Lyndon, it would have been a birthday party. By the time the convention got it started, we didn't have any opponents anymore. Some of it for tragic reasons, but we should have been the clear putative nominee at the beginning of that convention, so we could have made a more successful convention. The people with the president did not let up on almost anything. We tried to get a compromise on the Vietnam War, and we had the Kennedy people. There was a chance that we could have built a bridge there, but they wouldn't let it happen. And it was only that night when Humphrey gave his acceptance speech and you came up on the platform that the party and the convention was finally his. But it was too late. So I think there was another agenda there.
What do you think, Bill?
Well, I wasn't in the White House at that time. I had left in early 67, but I was in Hubert Humphrey's suite at in Chicago. And he had anticipated that LBJ might make a move. But by the time of the convention, I think he was totally persuaded that LBJ was not a force. But I don't know firsthand from the LBJ side. You were there, two of you were
well,
there.
Well, I actually wrote a speech for him to deliver at the convention.
Really?
And it's somewhere, I'm sure, in the LBJ library. But and then I went, and then I got a call. He was going to come at one point, and I got a call the day the convention started from somebody at the ranch. I don't remember who.
Larry Temple, maybe, or
Larry Temple, Jim Jones, maybe, Jim saying Jones. He wasn't. You know, by now there was trouble in Chicago. The president was not going to Chicago. I left the White House and went up to the Jersey Shore with my children. And watched it there, sadly. So the speech wasn't an acceptance speech. The speech was a birthday speech. Mm-hmm. So yeah, whether up until the last minute, I had no sense, Fritz, that he was going to run.
And you know, that is probably true. But you asked me what we thought, and there may have been nothing to it. But there was, because we couldn't get any management of that convention for about 3 days, we wondered why.
I was at the ranch and watched the convention in the office. There was a wing off the main house that contained the president's office. We watched the convention and the riots in that office with the president, who was quite miserable watching it. All that week that the convention was about to happen, the plane was there to take him to Chicago, and everybody was on tenterhooks about whether he would go. But I never had the slightest sense that he was hankering to be drafted. I think that's a kind of novel that people write in their minds. I think he was completely resigned, not reconciled, but completely resigned to the fact that in March he had said to the American people, "I will not seek nor will I accept the nomination of my party." I think that was very close to a Sherman statement. I think he meant it. I think he had deeply mixed feelings about what had happened to him, but I saw no sign during that convention when we were all down in Texas that he wanted to go and be drafted.
Joe?
I think that's right. I do think, I can't remember who was on the floor of the convention. I was not there either. But I do think he was constantly concerned that the party would rebuff him on the war. Remember, Hubert, we all say if he had only made the speech about the war a couple of weeks sooner than he had about Vietnam, he would have been elected president. But remember, he was on the rise. He only lost by less than one percentage point. But there was a lot of tension.
To me, one of the most interesting parts of all of that is that he had urged Rockefeller to seek the Republican nomination. I wonder what would have happened had Rockefeller wound up being the Republican.
Rockefeller, nominee. I honestly believe Rockefeller was his preferred candidate for president of the United States.
It's another
indication. And he brought Rockefeller down to the White House in a secret meeting to talk to him about that.
It's another indication of this weird bipartisanship of LBJ. He appreciated talent no matter which side of the aisle it was on, and he had great respect for Nelson Rockefeller's abilities. And I, as a young person in the White House, thought it was strange that the president was so willing to consort with these strange Republicans. But he admired Rockefeller.
You know, did you mean, Joe, that you think if Humphrey had been the nominee, he would have voted for Rockefeller?
I don't know what he would have done, but I do remember one thing about Rockefeller on that score. People forget, when Rockefeller got divorced and married Happy, it was a big scandal. I mean, it was a big deal in politics for that to happen. And there was a White House dinner, and he was going over the list with Liz Carpenter, and he said, "Ed Nelson Rockefeller, I want him down here with his new wife," and had him down.
We're kind of coming to the end of this, but I'd just like to go around and ask each of you, what do you think is the quality about Lyndon Johnson that today's politicians would do well to emulate, or what was it about him that they could learn from him that would help them the most? Senator McGovern, what would you say?
Well, I think we've all talked about his great skill in bringing people around to his point of view, or even if they didn't come to his point of view, at least cooperating. I think that was one of his enduring qualities, that he could bring a person of either party into the Oval Office or go to the Senate floor, whatever the case might be, and make a reasonable, persuasive answer. And he left no doubt that this was something that meant a lot to him, and that he felt it was in the best interest of the country. And I think that was his capacity for leadership that made him a great president.
Senator Mondale.
Well, I think what we talked about earlier, Robert Caro talked about, I think he genuinely and profoundly felt for poor people. I don't think it was a pose. And I think it drove his presidency, and he, every day of his life, wanted to make progress and make the lives of these poor people that he knew better. I felt it. I was there the night of the 65 Civil Rights Address when he said, "We shall overcome." That, I believe, is the most thrilling moment of my political career, because I could feel it in him. I knew he meant it. I knew he was going to do everything possible to create what is really a revolution. Mm-hmm. He got civil rights. No one else did. Mm-hmm. He got these big changes in education and so on, all these great, what I call the high tide, because I think he was, despite all of his negatives that we talked about tonight, deep down, he meant it with everything in his power, and he had the skills and the intention to do it. And he changed our country, and I think we should be forever grateful to him.
Richard, you'll remember that he knew the cost of getting civil rights passed. He,
yes.
In addition to saying, "We shall overcome," he said, "Well, when he signed that bill, there goes the South for the next half century."
Right.
Bill?
Well, it's hard to reduce that novel of a man to one concluding sentence, but it is to put yourself, when you can, on the right side of how you read history. That's what he did with the civil rights movement. His posture on civil rights was not all that admirable before he became president. And I remember one, what to me was the defining moment of his presidency. It was a press conference after he was arduously working to enact the Civil Rights Act or the Voting Rights Act, I forget which. And James Deacon, who was the White House correspondent for
St.
Louis Post-Dispatch, was at the back of the crowd, standing just a few of the press corps, and standing just a few feet from me. And he spoke up. Jim had this voice that would cut through. And he said, Mr. President, you didn't do very well on civil rights in Texas. You didn't do very well as a congressman. And why are you taking this stand now?" And there was this long pause. And I had no idea what he was going to say. And he said, "Well, Jim, I'll tell you, very few of us have the chance to correct the mistakes of our youth. And when you do, do it. I have that chance, and I'm going to do it now." He was reading his times in the context of the progressive evolution, start and stop of American government. I would say to any politician today, try to read the moment in the context of the long progressive history of this country, which has been one of constantly fighting, often losing, to advance the franchise of democracy. And that's what Johnson did when it mattered most.
You know,
it,
hearing you bring up Jim Deacon, Jim Deacon was a friend of mine. I covered, he was still covering the White House when I was the White House correspondent. But I remember that Jim always had a way of kind of holding his head. And Johnson always said, oh, you know, he's that reporter that looks like he just smelled something.
And he usually did.
Evan?
I would mention something that I think is shared by LBJ and FDR, his great mentor and hero, and that is a zest for politics. There has never been a great president who is not also a great politician. And if we have presidents who consider themselves above the political fray, who have a disdain for the sort of soiled, sweaty world of politics in the trenches, they are cutting themselves off from a chance to be great. There's never been a great president who didn't have a zest for political combat, political bargaining, for politics in the raw. FDR was a master of it, a patrician who somehow was able to connect with people from a completely different background. LBJ was skilled. He had what I call operational intelligence, not the trained kind of literary intellectualism that we think of when we talk about intelligence. He had operational intelligence, and it is essential to presidential greatness. And if I were advising later presidents, I would say, do not hold yourself above the fray. Be willing to get into the fray and develop those skills. Do whatever you have to do.
Joe.
I agree with what Urban said. I think you have to get into the battle. I think he had, in addition to all the political skills, he had such profound commitment. I think he had enormous courage. He knew he was paying a fearful price for everything he was doing, particularly in the civil rights area, as he told Bill about the 64 law. He knew the Voting Rights Act. He also knew that passing a law was just the beginning. And he was right there. I mean, we were filing lawsuits within days after the Voting Rights Act was passed to enforce it. We were calling everybody to get hospitals desegregated after Medicare went into effect. I mean, calling local leaders, and he knew all these guys, and he knew you had to do it, that was just the beginning. And at the same time, he knew how important the law was, because all the civil rights leaders wanted him to sign an executive order on fair housing. And he said the next president can revoke the order. He knew how unpopular fair housing would be. And he said, we've got to get a law. And he got the law. So I would say courage, tenacity, and he loved every minute of schmoozing with everybody on the Hill, everybody, you know, out there that was a politician, that was a businessman, that was a labor leader. And when George Meany recommended something, he'd call the head of the business council to see what he thought about it, and vice versa. He knew how this country ran, and he knew how it was driven and how you achieve something, and he was willing to touch every single lever to get it done. We need that. Great.
I want to just close this with one little personal story. Lyndon Johnson was the first politician that I ever knew or even knew about. The year was 1948. I was 11 years old. And we heard that Lyndon Johnson, who was running for the United States Senate, this was the year of Truman versus Dewey, we heard Lyndon Johnson was coming to the baseball vacant lot on the northwest side of Fort Worth where we played baseball. And we heard he was coming. And it was a big thing in the community. And my dad took me down there. And the reason we were all so excited about going down there is we heard he was coming in a helicopter. And none of us had ever seen a helicopter. This was a long time ago. So on that day, we all went down there, and we're standing there in this vacant lot. And all of a sudden, we hear this big noise up in the sky. And here's this airplane with no wings on it. And we hear coming over this bullhorn, "This is your candidate for the United States Senate." I mean, we were like, you know, Moses when he realized that burning bush. We didn't know if it was a politician. We didn't know if it was God. We didn't know what it was. I mean, just this thing, and it landed, and there was this big cloud of dust, and Lyndon Johnson got out of that helicopter, and he made the most rousing speech you can ever want to hear. And at the end of it, he never took off his hat during the speech. At the end of the speech, he took off his hat and threw it into the crowd, and then got on that helicopter and flew away. Now, mind you, I was 11 years old. I can remember every moment of that day. I can't remember the commercials from the last presidential campaign, but I can remember every minute of that day. Well, let me tell you what. I later told that story to Jake Pickle, who was a longtime congressman from Austin, and Jake said, oh, yeah, said, that was my job in the campaign. And I said, what do you mean your job? He said, well, I was going to the University of Texas, but my job was to drive around to wherever that helicopter was going and get in the front of the line there, and at the end of the speech, I was the guy that caught the hat. He said, LBJ said, he was the tightest guy on earth. He wasn't going to waste a hat on a political rally. So he said, I'd have to drive around, catch that hat, then run around behind the helicopter, give it to him, and then he'd go on to the next rally. And every time I think of that day, and I think about how politics was then, and you talk about how he had this great zest for politics, Joe. He got out there, and in those days, politicians knew who the people were that they were talking to. They weren't relying on a piece of paper that some pollster had given them. They weren't relying on some poll that somebody had written. They knew who they were talking to, and I think that's, you hit it, I think all of you talked about it in a certain way. He knew who the people were that he represented. And that's why he was able to do. He knew who the people were in the Senate that he dealt with. He knew who the people were in the government. That's how he was able to get so much done. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. Mm-hmm. Hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. Thank you.
Thanks for being on the program. Yeah, I enjoyed that.